In the previous parts of this video series, related to the brain, I have shown the superficial and deeper brain structures. This part, being the last of the 5-part video series, covers the cerebellum, the cranial nerves, and other brain structures and aspects which could not be covered in the previous part of the video series. Seeing now is the optic nerve, that is the second cranial nerve. The optic nerve transmits brightness, perception, color perception, and contrast. It extends from the optic disc to the optic chiasma. The optic chiasma is located at the bottom of the brain, immediately inferior to the hypothalamus. At the chiasma, fibers from the nasal halves of the retina cross, while those from the temporal halves remain uncrossed and continue as optic tracts. In this way, the optic tracts contain fibers conveying information from both eyes. Thus, damage to the optic tract on one side results in partial blindness in both eyes, while injury to one optic nerve therefore results in total blindness of that eye and loss of bilateral pupillary light reflex. The pupillary light reflex refers to the constriction of both pupils that occurs when light is shown into either eye. The pathway being retina, optic nerve, tract, lateral geniculate body, Edinger-Westphal nucleus to both sides ciliary ganglion via oculomotor nerve and finally bilateral pupillary constriction. Continuing further, the visual tracts from the optic tract synapse in lateral geniculate body. Axons from the lateral geniculate body form the optic radiation, which is divided into two parts. The upper optic radiation carries fibers from the superior retinal quadrants corresponding to the inferior visual field quadrants. It travels through the parietal lobe to reach the visual cortex. And lower optic radiation, which carries fibers from the inferior retinal quadrants corresponding to the superior visual field quadrants, it travels through the temporal lobe via a pathway known as Meyer's loop to reach the visual cortex. There are substantial number of fibers in each optic tract that bypass the lateral geniculate body synapse, pass over the medial geniculate body in a bundle called the brachia of the superior colliculus, and terminate in the superior colliculus. The superior colliculus or SC receiving visual information from both the eyes and other pathways, making it a major center for initiating eye movements and coordinating them with movements of the head and neck. The medial geniculate body is the thalamic processing center of the auditory pathway. It has projections to and from the inferior colliculus, the auditory cortex, and the thalamic reticular nucleus, or TRN. The trochlear nerve or cranial nerve 4 is the only cranial nerve to exit the dorsal side of the brainstem. Innervate the contralateral or opposite side superior oblique muscle of the eye. Damage to the trochlear nerve will result in a loss of this eye movement and may produce double vision or diplopia. Cerebellar peduncles connect the cerebellum to the brainstem. There are 3 cerebellar peduncles on each side. Superior cerebellar peduncle connects the cerebellum to the midbrain. They represent the main output route from the cerebellum. Middle cerebellar peduncles connect the cerebellum to the pons. Inferior cerebellar peduncles form the lateral border of the 4th ventricle and form a distinctive diamond, the middle peduncle forming the central corners of the diamond, while the superior and inferior peduncles form the superior and inferior edges respectively. The posterior part of the medulla is visible now. The dorsal or posterior surface of the medulla faces the fourth ventricle of the brain. The central canal of the spinal cord, which is an inferior continuation of the fourth ventricle, also courses through the dorsal half of the medulla, carrying the cerebrospinal fluid or CSF. The sulcus visible in the middle of the dorsal surface of the medulla oblongata is called the dorsal median sulcus. This sulcus is continuous with the posterior spinal sulcus. On each side of the dorsal median sulcus, there are two vertical prominences that run in parallel to the sulcus. One that is located immediately lateral to the sulcus is formed by the gracile fasciculus that ascends from the spinal cord. The cranial part of the gracile fasciculus contains the gracile nucleus, a relay nucleus that synapses with the fibers of the gracile fasciculus. The gracile nucleus forms a visible enlargement referred to as the gracile tubercle. Lateral to each gracile fasciculus is another vertical prominence formed by the cuneate fasciculus. The cuneate fasciculus is formed by the cuneate nucleus, which is a relay nucleus for the cuneate fasciculus. Lateral to the ventrolateral sulci are the olives. The olives are swelling in the medulla containing various nuclei and efferent fibers. Lateral and dorsal to the olives are the rootlets for cranial nerve 9 or glossopharyngeal nerve and cranial nerve 10, the vagus nerve, and cranial nerve 11, accessory nerve. Emerging from the ventrolateral sulci are the hypoglossal nerve rootlets. The pons is now visible with the cranial nerve 5 or the trigeminal nerve, emerging at the level of the midpons. Now you see the pituitary gland, a pea-sized reddish-gray body that stores hormones from the hypothalamus and releases them into the bloodstream. The pituitary gland is supported within the cella turcica of the sphenoid bone with the skull. It is composed of the following lobes: anterior, intermediate, and posterior. The anterior pituitary or adenohypophysis regulates stress, growth, reproduction, and lactation. The intermediate synthesizes and secretes melanocyte-stimulating hormone. The posterior pituitary or neurohypophysis is functionally connected to the hypothalamus by the median eminence via a small tube called the pituitary stalk, also called the infundibular stalk or infundibulum. The mammillary bodies mentioned earlier as being connected to the terminal ends of the anterior arches of the fornix is now visible here in the interpeduncular fossa. It forms part of the limbic system. The oculomotor nerve or cranial nerve 3 is seen arising from the midbrain. Oculomotor neurons project orbital muscles on the same side of the head. The midbrain is the uppermost part of the brainstem. The main parts of the midbrain are the cerebral peduncles, substantia nigra, tegmentum, cerebral aqueduct, and the tectum. The almond-sized hypothalamus is located below the thalamus and sits just above the brainstem. All vertebrate brains have a hypothalamus. Its primary function is to maintain homeostasis, or stability of the internal environment in the body. The hypothalamus links the nervous and endocrine systems by way of the pituitary gland. Its function is to secrete releasing hormones and inhibiting hormones that stimulate or inhibit, like their names imply, production of hormones in the anterior pituitary gland. The cerebellum or little brain overlies the posterior aspects of the pons and medulla oblongata and is present in the posterior fossa of the skull. Now, the three cerebellar peduncles can be seen. The superior cerebellar peduncle is merely an output to the cerebral cortex, carrying fibers from the deep cerebellar nuclei via the thalamic nuclei to upper motor neurons in the cerebral cortex. The middle cerebellar peduncle, the largest of the three peduncles, receives input from the pons, mainly from the pontine nuclei. The input to the pons is from the cerebral cortex. The inferior cerebellar peduncle receives input from the vestibular nuclei, spinal cord, and the tegmentum. Output from the inferior peduncle is via efferent fibers to the vestibular nuclei and the reticular formation. The whole of the cerebellum receives modulatory input from the inferior olivary nucleus via the inferior cerebellar peduncle. The cerebellum consists of two paired lateral lobes and a midline portion known as the vermis. There are nine lobules of the vermis: lingula, central lobule, culmen, clivus, folium of the vermis, tuber, pyramid, uvula, and nodule. Each lateral lobule can be further subdivided into three lobes: the anterior lobe above the primary or preclavar fissure, the posterior lobe below the primary fissure, and the flocculonodular lobe below the horizontal fissure. The flocculus is contained within the flocculonodular lobe. The cerebellar tonsil is a rounded lobule on the undersurface of each cerebellar hemisphere, continuous medially with the uvula of the cerebellar vermis and superiorly by the flocculonodular lobe. Here we have traveled the whole brain anatomy in 5 parts, and here this video series ends. For the viewers who have watched only few parts of this video series, I would advise them to watch all 5 parts in sequential order to understand the whole brain anatomy clearly.